Good morning, everyone. Can I welcome everyone to the 12th meeting in 2015 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Everyone present is reminded to switch off mobile phones as they can affect the broadcasting system. As meeting papers are provided in digital format, you may see tablets being used during the meeting. No apologies have been received, although Mary Fee has given notice that she may arrive late. Our first agenda item is for the committee to continue to take evidence on access to Scotland's major urban railways. Can I welcome George Mair, Director of the Confederation of Passenger Transport Scotland, Nathan Kaczmarski, Senior Communications Officer at Cycling Scotland, Tony Kenmuir of the Scottish Taxi Federation, and last but not least, John Lauder, National Director at SUSTRANS. And Alec Johnson is going to kick off our questions this morning.
Thank you very much, Convener. Could I begin by asking, how would your organisations characterise the accessibility of Scotland's major railway stations? Oh, feel free.
If you don't mind then, good morning, members and convener. I've been conferring with our colleagues at Scottish Accessible Transport, and we've been discussing in particular over the last couple of days access to Waverley Station. So if you don't mind me holding the floor for a couple of minutes, I can. I've actually had a look over the website this morning just to make sure that my information is completely current. For a couple of minutes, I'll walk you through, if I may, my experience of attempting to engage with a taxi from the capital's main train station. So if you access the website for Edinburgh Waverley Station, disabled access in particular is a very prominent link on the front page of the website, and that's commendable. If you follow that link and request assistance, you're then presented with 10 different phone numbers that it's possible to ring or text to obtain assistance when you arrive at the train station. At the foot of those phone numbers, where I think things are beginning to go wrong, there's a note that says, if you need help around the station, speak to a member of staff or go to East Coast reception next to the taxi rank. So that's the first spot, the deliberate mistake. There is no longer a taxi rank in Waverley Station. So following on from there, on the same page, there's a link to taxis. And there's a note there that says the taxi rank is on Waverley Bridge. The rank in the station has closed. So there's conflicting information immediately about how to get egress, presumably because you're already in the station, or be dropped off by a taxi. Under the note that says that the taxi rank in the station has closed, it says for more information, visit Train Taxi. And there's a link to an organisation called Train Taxi who provide information. And they ask you, first of all, there's a little field that asks you to type in which train station you want information for. And Waverley Station doesn't exist. So I tried various combinations of Edinburgh-Waverley and Waverley-Edinburgh. Eventually, I just tried Edinburgh, and there are three stations listed, Edinburgh, Haymarket-Edinburgh, and Edinburgh Park. I clicked the link for Edinburgh, and the title Edinburgh came up within brackets, also known as Edinburgh-Waverley. So following that link, the wording there, there's a short paragraph that says, Edinburgh is a major station with taxis usually available on a rank. No, there aren't. Advanced booking is not normally necessary or even possible. That's an astonishing comment. Unless arriving early in the morning or late at night, operators who may accept bookings include central taxis, city cabs, and radio cabs. Now, that would come as news to radio cabs who ceased trading 15 years ago. So at the foot of that, and this is my final bit of evidence on this particular topic, all or some of the vehicles used by these operators are understood to be wheelchair accessible. Now, in the case of central taxis and city cabs, they are licensed public taxis, so they're entirely wheelchair accessible. That's one of their licensing conditions. And it says, please check availability before travelling. So in providing my evidence, I would put it to the members and the convener that without foreknowledge of Waverley Station and how it works and recent changes there, for a traveller arriving by taxi or attempting to leave by taxi, the information that's being provided is woefully contradictory. Mm-hmm. If that answers your question.
It's certainly consistent with some of the things we've heard previously. do any of the rest of you have comments on accessibility to the major railway stations?
I'm happy to pick up from the point of view of pedestrians and people using bicycles getting to stations, the main stations. In my evidence, I've referred throughout to the red line that is drawn round a station when it's being either upgraded or developed. And I think that what that does is it creates a culture whereby the station that's being renovated, regenerated, or indeed built inside the station is actually very, very good to move around in. The new one, Haymarket, the improved Waverley, very, very good to move around in. But because the red line that it seems to me Network Rail draw around a station when it's being developed focuses their attention inside the red line only, then what happens out with that red line makes it really quite difficult to get to stations, because there seems to me to be a lack of communication between Network Rail and the local authority who are providing the road and the streetscape around the station. So, for example, it's quite difficult to get to Haymarket Station simply because it's very busy. It's a busy area. There's a lot of people using it. It's been redeveloped. It's been redeveloped to include a tram system now as well. And in addition to that, despite being redeveloped in a very, very good station when you're inside it, the narrow pavements on the approach to it still remain. So it's very, very busy and congested at peak times. And that does strike me as a lack of, if I can use the expression, just being joined up from the point of view that you develop a station at considerable cost, you make it really good, but you don't improve the area for, say, a mile round it where you might walk, or 3 miles where you might get to it by bicycle. And in addition, the Haymarket, there have been all kind of tensions around access for taxi ranks as well. The other issue that we found with Haymarket, which astonished me, was that we were unable to have a back door to it to access it from the Dalry side of the line. So which then meant that anyone approaching Haymarket from the west side of the rail line was still on the same narrow pavement that existed before the station was improved. And there was actually a very easy to us option to create a back door into Haymarket, similar to the Market Street entrance at Waverley, from the Distillery Lane next to Haymarket Station. And that was never developed, and we were told consistently by Network Rail this cannot be delivered. To the point of me backing away from that, because I was getting to the point where I felt I was really annoying Network Rail to the point where I couldn't go any further, and I didn't want to, because we want to work in partnership with Network Rail, but I was getting to the point where I felt I had done all I could with that, so I had to withdraw from that. And my final point, again, it's again about the red line that's drawn around the redeveloped stations, is that we fully support redeveloping the stations. They are really good when they are done, but you know, one of the major concerns we have with the proposals for Queen Street Station, for example, is that, again, there doesn't seem to be an assessment done of how people walking, cycling, and very probably bus and taxi too, are going to get to the station. I would imagine the redeveloped Queen Street will be great when you're in it, but my worry is, how do you get to it? Is there any change at all? And the final example, I suppose, poor old Haymarket, but it needs to be cited, is that despite being developed at a multi-million pound development, which has given a very good concourse, there was no improvement to the cycle parking. Now, we have an aim, a nationally agreed vision, that 10% of all trips will be, 10% of everyday trips will be by bicycle by 2020. And I would have thought that we would have had an improved position with the ability to park more bicycles at Haymarket, and in fact that was not delivered as part of the scheme, and we're now retrofitting an improved parking for bicycles in partnership with Network Rail and also with the City of Edinburgh Council, but we're doing that with money that we've had to find, as opposed to it coming out of the Egypt budget, which is a huge budget. And I would have thought that the £500,000 that's being needed to help build that new cycle parking could have been found from that budget rather than being found from other budgets now and pieced together in a retrospective point of view. So I think a lack of joined upness is my comment, not a very good expression, but just a lack of cohesion, which I think is caused by only looking at within the red line of the station and not at anything outside that red line.
Yes, thank you. You mentioned Queen Street, and I was going to ask this question later on, mainly to Tony Kenmuir, but might be others want to answer it. The Queen Street's excellent just now. I mean, in terms of taxis anyway, Queen Street's excellent. You get out, you get on your taxi, and you get away. Doesn't seem to be any issues. What concerns do you have about the redeveloped Queen Street, and what role have you had in making sure that the accessibility to taxis and other things are going to be of the same high standard as it is just now?
On you go, John.
Okay, I'll be quick, as quick as I can be. We've got some real, quite profound concerns about the proposals for the redeveloped station. We initially did write, give a reply to the to Network Rail, who were seeking through their consultation. And we submitted our ideas and our concerns to them. And initially, the initial reaction was one of, we got a letter pretty much as anyone else would get a letter. So any constituent or any other member of the public. So we had to do a bit more work to get a chance to meet Network Rail and actually sit down with them. Because, you know, we do have some skills in this, we think, and we've got we are managing funds on behalf of the government, so you know we have some funding that we could have helped to provide for this area. So we did get that meeting with Network Rail, but it was very hard. It was hard won, and since then I've continued to be really quite worried about Queen Street, and I still am. And for two reasons, really. One of them I've alluded to before. That's the red line. So what's happening outside that red line doesn't seem to be. It seems to be the role of Glasgow City Council to sort it out somehow. And there doesn't seem to be any way for Network Rail to work with the City Council to work together on planning how patrons will get to the station itself. So that just worries me, because it makes me think it's already quite a busy area around the station. Will it remain very busy? So if you're trying to get there on a bicycle, will the streets around it still remain busy? The second concern is that in looking at the plans, after a series of meetings, we were shown drawings. We understand why the interior of the station will be constrained, because the platforms need to be extended, and we understand that, which makes the space available within the station to park bicycles limited. But there didn't seem to be any real plan to provide any better or improved cycle parking at all around the stations. And as I've put in my evidence, my big worry, and what I found a bit perplexing, is that there is a proposal to have a sort of a short shopping mall under the multi-storey car park, which will be built next to the station. But there was no plan to use that as an area that you might have had the type of bicycle park or hub that you would get in any other big city in Northern Europe, or indeed Leeds or London. That was very much earmarked for shopping. And for retail, and it was under the control of a different part of Network Rail, and the two didn't seem to be speaking together. So I found that worrying, and I still find it quite worrying. Where we are now is that we've had a series of meetings, we've shown on the drawings where we think a cycle parking area could go, and we're now back at square one, where we're going to start again. So we're going to start the whole process of looking at the drawings again with Network Rail. So I remain worried about Queen Street.
I come back to you. I've got questions to ask you later on, and at that point, I'll ask you the question about Queen Street. You okay with that?
Okay. Can I just say that, briefly, convener, can I just add that as a trade association, we've had a great deal of involvement in the Queen Street redevelopment. That's not to say that operators in Glasgow haven't been involved in relation to the site and the bus stops and public transport. What I do know is that we've recently been invited by SPT to participate in a transport integration forum that will include
the current ScotRail franchisee, as well as Network Rail. So there may be opportunities through that forum to have detailed discussions on some of the issues that would concern the committee.
David, you wanted to come in briefly.
Just a very brief question to Mr. Kenmuir. I've been advised that the reason that taxis are out of Waverley and are above ground was through security advice from the UK government and security services. Now, is that a myth, or do you have any evidence that that's actually genuine advice? And it's the type of station, so stations that are not as enclosed might not have the same advice, because obviously otherwise my concern would be every time we have a station development, we have to take taxis out with the concourse of the station.
Yeah, that's an excellent point. We were given the same story. So our understanding is that our unceremonious ejection from Waverley Station was for security reasons. And I have to commend the City Council for their reaction to developing accommodation on the street. That's not just an issue at Waverley Station. It ties in with Queen Street and also with Haymarket. So the reasons we were given for vehicles not being allowed into Waverley anymore underground was security. However, very hard on the heels of that, we were also expelled, if that's the right word, from Haymarket train station in Edinburgh. We weren't given any particular reason for that other than the lack of a drop-off area. So if you're familiar with and you can picture Haymarket station, the old entrance, which has a little off-road turn-in, was formerly the taxi stance. If taxis were over-ranked there, or if there were other vans and deliveries, or if there were an excess of people attempting to drop off, unfortunately, through the development of the Edinburgh tram, it would mean any over-ranking or any excess vehicles would be causing an obstruction there. So there were a combination of reasons why we left Haymarket, and we're now across the street. That was a lack of space, a lack of a drop-off, particularly for people with special needs, and the possibility of encroaching on tram tracks. And also, the cycle community have a special lane now, which takes them off the main thoroughfare into that drop-off area and back out in order to avoid crossing the tram lines at too shallow an angle and causing spills, which unfortunately is widely publicised is still an issue. One point I'd like to make about this, you might think that it's a highly emotive and confrontational subject for us being decanted from a train station. Actually, it has distinct benefits. It means that taxis are able to pick up the general public without paying anybody for the privilege. And that really is a big issue for us, where transport hubs take it upon themselves to have a permit system or a levy or a toll of some sort, where they charge us as a public transport provider for dropping off the general public and for picking them up again. You know, frankly, in most cases, we regard that as an abuse of a dominant position. Unfortunately, most of the taxi community are small businessmen, independent, and don't have the resources to combat it. But actually being out on the street can be a benefit.
I'm not necessarily in reply to this. I'm merely perhaps put on the record, convener, that I personally don't have a problem if the reason for the taxi move was because of security advice. And I understand, having some experience of this building, that clearly security services don't give you the specifics of that. However, I think the police would confirm that security advice was given or not given. And I think passengers and perhaps taxi industry would perhaps understand the reasons better if we were told generally, yes, there was security advice given, you have to move out. That's perfectly understandable. But I think there is genuine confusion. And I'm sure it may be that we contact the police just to get some confirmation that this happened in the case of Waverley and perhaps other stations as well.
We were very conscious that the space that was formerly occupied by taxis was converted to an indoor market very quickly. So it was converted into retail accommodation. And you can take from that what you will.
Alec, you've been very patient while other members have sought to hijack your own questions.
participation. I want to get the two other members of the panel in who haven't had much opportunity. I want to know about your issues about accessibility, but we've also strayed into the next question already, and I'd like to also know your views on the issues regarding the apparent lack of coordination that exists between local authorities, Network Rail and transport providers. I think Mr. Lauder called it the red line issue, but I'd particularly like to hear your views on that issue.
Yes, in terms of the second point I'll take first, in terms of coordination, John had touched upon the Cycling Action Plan for Scotland's, the shared vision of 10% of everyday journeys will be by bike. Specific within both the original CAPS document as well as the refreshed version in 2013, there is specific reference to ScotRail, Network Rail, rail integration, cycling and rail being key complementary journey modes. Also, in terms of the long-term vision for active travel in Scotland, it also talks about transport integration and actually provides a very good overview about what would make an accessible station in terms of information, in terms of parking, in terms of clear routes, and things like that. I wanted to touch upon the opportunities there because for the CAPS, the Cycling Action Plan for Scotland delivery form is made up of a range of stakeholders, including ScotRail, Abellio have come along, and in their most recent CAPS delivery forum, they actually had a presentation that talked about the door-to-door journey. I'll touch upon that in a second, but I guess I wanted to note there is that there are plenty of opportunities within that for anyone involved in, particularly for the Queen Street redevelopment and anything else that's actually being developed in terms of rail, to get information of best practice, because there is actually a lot out there. From cycle hire that's been put in place in Glasgow and Stirling, to the Stirling Cycle Hub, which is identified as a pilot project, which has been successful thus far and could be a model for rolling out, to Abellio's own identification of cycle points and other various things that they would like to put in place at rail stations. That is all discussed at these forums, and similar to what George noted, there are forums out there for best practice and examples like that to be explained and provided. Now, in terms of access, as I just mentioned there, we'd like to focus on the door-to-door journey. So it's many of the stations identified specifically in the study that you're looking at here and the evidence that you're gathering and the surveys that you've undertaken are within a huge population, both in terms of people who live there but also work. But to understand what is needed in terms of access, it's important to understand the door-to-door journey. So what people are actually traveling to do, what is their destination, what is their origin. John's touched upon parking and things like that, and Queen Street is a very good example. In terms of what everyone in the cycling community and probably many other modes and other communities have fed back is that access is of course important. There is the ambition at the moment to put in improved cycle parking. There is the identification from Abellio, from other areas, that there is it is possible to incorporate these into these mainline stations. They want to do it. There's the drive to do it. That's been supported by cycling organizations. It's a very important thing to understand and make sure that people are able to make those door-to-door journeys. So when they arrive at a station, they can store their bike, and then they can carry on their onward journey. However, in terms of the feedback on following the Queen Street, the responses from Network Rail, the responses on the back of that consultation, as John has pointed out, it's not clear that that ambition is being taken on board. So as I mentioned, there's plenty of opportunity there to identify good practice, not only from the continent, from the experience, but also in Scotland itself through the Stirling Cycle Hub and the cycle hire schemes that we have in place. Plus, as John mentioned, in Leeds and London, there's already cycle parking and other integrated transport schemes that have been successful.
Thank you.
I would concur with John's thoughts on this red line around the station. I think in many locations there are good practices in place, and that may well be down to the local bus manager and the local station manager that they've worked jointly together and put things in place to help with bus information and bus stop locations and such like. I think there's a need for a more consistent approach in that, and I, as an industry representative group, we are happy to engage with ScotRail and Abellio and National Rail to try and facilitate that. I think it's an interesting point about security, because I would have thought the security issue is one that should apply in all stations. Yet, where I live in Aberdeen, the station taxi rank is a pane of glass away from the main concourse. So, you know, it's an interesting, if it's good for one, surely should be good for the other or otherwise. But I recognise there are things that the industry and the Network Rail and ScotRail need to work better on in terms of providing information and facilities for public transport information.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting that that taxi rank in Aberdeen is also below street level in much the same way as it used to be in Waverley. The final thing I'd like to ask is, we've talked a lot about the lack of coordination, but do you think Transport Scotland, as the major funder of both ScotRail and Network Rail, has been sufficiently clear in directing both organisations to maximise accessibility to stations? Do you think they have a role?
Yes, I do. Have an important role to play, whether it's a dictatorial role or one that advocates closer collaboration between the local authority, Network Rail, ScotRail, and the bus industry. I think they have a major role to play in that respect.
Mm-hmm. Do you think they've done anything, or should they be doing something?
My understanding is that they are doing something now. My understanding is that there'll be a chief executive and then two directors, one for ScotRail and one for Network Rail, working together as a team. I think that's a really, really good development. Because I think it's tackling a culture where Network Rail pretty much did its stuff and ScotRail ran the trains on the infrastructure that Network Rail provided. But an awful lot of things fell between, you know, the cracks. I agree with George. I think Transport Scotland have got a leadership role in ensuring that everyone works in a much more cohesive way. The transport community is quite a small community, really. We regularly give evidence to you, so you know that there's a fairly small band of key operators, and there's bound to be a willingness to work together, I think. I don't think there's any indication anybody wouldn't want to work together. You need to bring those people together. And in a team effort, it's that separation between the Network Rail and the local authority, as George has indicated. How do we bring those closer together and really make that a much better experience for the patron getting to and from the station? So I'm hopeful, actually, and I think the appointment of Abellio could be a really good development.
Is there a danger that we're at the stage now where, in the case of Waverley, the development has been completed, and in other areas where it's still to be completed, the plans at least have been finalised? Are we in a danger of having missed the boat a bit on that?
I suppose we are, yes. I mean, that's my worry with Queen Street, is that the plans seem fairly well developed and we're kind of retrofitting bits in now. That's a wee bit of a worry for me, yes. That would be my major worry, I think, would be around Queen Street Station. But I think the other thing that's a slight concern is an awful lot's being hinged on Abellio to make these changes. So I just hope they get enough support to be able to make all the changes that they're indicating, because there must be a huge amount of pressure on them now to deliver the change. But that said, it's a hopeful sign that there'll be a more cohesive team at the top.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I return to the issue of access to Edinburgh Waverley Station that we've already touched on this morning? The committee has heard previously evidence from Transform Scotland, Transport Focus and the Mobility and Access Committee for Scotland that closure of the vehicle access ramps at Edinburgh Waverley Station has significantly worsened accessibility for both pedestrians and cyclists, and that this has had a particular impact on access for older and disabled people. Do you have a view on that?
The setup at Waverley Station, I've tried it myself, working my way from one platform to the other, and it's an excellent system of elevators, but it strikes me as something out of Charlie and the Chocolate Factory and the Great Glass Elevator. It is like solving a Rubik's Cube, trying to navigate your way from one part of the station to the other, up, along, down, along, up, along. I believe the key concern for access from a taxi point of view is that when we're dropping somebody off at the entrance, most wheelchair users understand that they need to make arrangements ahead of ahead of travelling in order to be met and assisted with luggage or access, whatever. They can still have a bit of a wait for somebody to appear to assist them. And I think an issue at the moment is that the best entrances for dropping off and collecting, well, the best one is Calton Road, but being dropped off there, a person is very isolated until somebody arrives to assist them. So there would be a burden on whoever's dropping them off there to wait perhaps an extended period of time. And you know, I've referred to the instructions on the website for how to get assistance, and even that's something of a maze to navigate your way through to find out who you should contact for assistance. So I think that the distance of the entrances and exits, if you've seen, for example, at Waverley Steps on Princes Street, the elevator there is around the back of the shopping centre. It's a fair distance from the road, so even getting there is an issue. And another problem, this is perhaps a problem with taxis being now out on the street and the entrances being relatively small and mostly providing just an elevator to get you downstairs. There are no trolleys available. So when you have somebody elderly with a bit of luggage, or you have somebody perhaps in a wheelchair who can't carry anything, finding a way to convey their luggage. It's not possible to leave a taxi, for example, anywhere in the vicinity while you go into the station, get a trolley, bring it back out, get them loaded up, get them into the station. There's nowhere to leave a vehicle, simply nowhere to park it. So I think that's an enormous issue.
So issues around older and disabled people being able to access taxi services, but there's also an impact on your ability to provide that service.
Yeah, I'm thinking about taxi services really only from the point of view of providing a service to people who want to enter and leave the station. You know, I'm leaving our commercial interests out of it. But I think that abandoning somebody on Market Street or in Calton Road or on Princes Street in a wheelchair with luggage or elderly people who need some sort of assistance, there's just nowhere for us to stop and wait and make sure that someone from the station engages with them. We have no control, no contact there at all.
Can these temporary measures be improved, or are you looking for the ban to be revoked? What's your position?
We don't need access for the vehicles into the station. I think the key for us would be having a designated space for pick up and drop off. If everybody who required assistance went to Calton Road, and there was a ready connection with somebody who could provide them with assistance along with some trolleys, that would be a major step forward.
With Network Rail, in order to try and find a solution?
None
to the
whatsoever.
And what consultation did Network Rail engage in prior to imposing the ban on vehicles into the station?
None whatsoever.
Okay. And you talked about the justification for the ban being issues around security, and my colleague, Mr. Stewart, has already referred to that. But you also seem to imply that you thought that the real justification might have been around increasing the retail footprint within the station. Have you got any evidence for that?
That was an observation rather than an implication.
Okay. Have you anything else to go on by way of evidence to support that observation?
No.
Okay. That's very helpful. Does anyone else have anything specifically on taxis before we move on to...
Can I just point out, you've probably already heard this, if you have, just stop me, but by closing the vehicle access is from Market Street, it has meant that people using bicycles have to share a very narrow pavement with pedestrians. Sorry, convener.
So I'll allow you to elaborate at length on that point in just a moment. in terms of, you know, cyclist access being restricted because they're now having to share that narrow space on the north rampway in particular with pedestrians and tourists and others with small children. You, I think, have highlighted what appears to be a solution to that in your evidence to the committee. Do you want to say a little bit about that?
Yeah, I, to me, the barriers that are there at the moment look like they were put up in an absolute emergency, and they're just a physical block. And you have revamped security around the building here, and you have some substantial bollards, but they're still permeable. You can get past them, and I would have thought it's perfectly possible to have bollards that can go up and down. That happens all over the place. It's very simple. It's a well-tested technology. There was a simple barrier that was there before, actually, which may have had not been robust enough for the security measures that were needed, but worked perfectly well. It was easy to just go by on your bicycle, and it didn't mean you were clattering people's shins with your pedal as you were apologising your way down into the station with your bicycle. So I would have it'll be a 10-minute job for a junior engineer to design something quite simple that will work perfectly well.
On that point, and similar question to what I asked Mr. Kenmuir, what discussions are you currently having with Network Rail in order to find a solution?
I'm worn out with that, I'm afraid. I mean, we all tried over and over and over again, and we're just nowhere.
And what do you think that says about Network Rail's approach to engaging with stakeholders on issues of mutual concern and issues that are very much in the public interest?
Surprising from a public body.
Okay, tell me a bit more.
Well, I'm not being facetious. It's just you would expect you would never expect an airport to make it that difficult to get in and out. So I'm surprised it's that difficult to get in and out of a railway station, a really busy station, where it's obvious there's a narrow footway. It must be clear to the staff to the management of Network Rail that's a really poor visitor experience, and a poor daily experience if you're commuting and you're using a bicycle or any kind of substantial luggage for that matter. It doesn't, or a wheelchair. I am really surprised. It's public money after all. I would have thought it could be used in a better way, a more welcoming way for people who are paying to use the train system.
Okay, can I just ask the same question to you, Mr. Lauder, Mr. Mair, and Mr. Kaczmarski, in terms of consultation? What formal consultation was there with your organisation from Network Rail on the ban that was imposed on vehicle access?
I'm happy to be corrected, but none. But I'm happy to be corrected if there was.
Certainly in my 6 years in this job, I've never met Network Rail, so none at all.
Same with us. We haven't had any.
So there's no formal consultation?
Not with us. Not with
right,
us.
Okay. That's helpful. That is now on the record. And just finally, in terms of vehicle access ramps and vehicle access to the station, it's interesting, Mr. Kenmuir, that you weren't looking for the ban to be lifted and for taxis to have access into the station. Is that the view of the other witnesses?
Yep. I'd be delighted for the ban to be lifted as long as there's no permit system or levy or charge in some way, shape or form for allowing taxis to engage with the general public. So we'd be delighted to be in undercover and providing a service. No objection to being there, but have no particular desire to pay them £1,600 per year per taxi for the privilege.
And how realistic is that?
Remains to be seen.
Right, okay. But, I mean, you have highlighted a possible solution which wouldn't involve taxis re-entering the station. How do you intend to take that issue forward?
I'm not sure I understand the question. I apologise.
Well, you said that it would be possible to reconfigure arrangements without taxis going back into the station. Mm-hmm. Now, how's that going to happen? What attempts are you making to engage with Network Rail in order to make that?
Well, at all stations presently, it's commonplace all over the United Kingdom for taxis to be outside a train station at each entrance exit and forming a rank. Generally, there's some sort of cover. Generally, there's some sort of access to trolleys. And generally, there's reasonable signage. Those things are lacking at the moment, notably in Edinburgh. However, being on the street near the entrance isn't a huge issue in itself.
And Mr. Lauder, what's your view on whether vehicles should be allowed back into the station? Well, if that's not the solution,
vehicles do get back into the station, I think, for deliveries, and bus operators use it when there's an emergency and a line's closed. I've seen buses coming down in. My personal observation is that the station is quieter. The ambience is maybe better now that taxis aren't in and out, but that's not, I've taken on board everything Tony has said. So if the taxi industry can work well and it's working for patrons, then I have no real firm view on whether the taxis should or shouldn't be in the station. But, the observation remains that because the two ramps at Market Street are so very, very difficult to access, more could be done to use them better than they are being used at the moment.
The vehicle access ramp to be reopened for pedestrians and for cyclists.
It makes total sense to me, and the dropping your bollard is quite an easy thing to do, and it happens all over the place. So I fail to see why it can't be done.
Yeah. Okay, Mr. Mair.
I think that I accept the point that Tony's made in general terms. I think getting people that struggle with the technology of lifts and elevators and various other things and a lack of facilities for luggage, there may be a need to think through. The closer we can get people that struggle with these kind of things to the concourse, the better it is for them. And if that can be done in a safe manner, then why not, would be my question.
Okay. And finally, Mr. Kaczmarski.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's to echo again, sort of emphasise a point that if the priority is getting people who have disabilities or mobility aids or need to carry large things to get into the station, if they are comfortable, that's the first priority. So any changes need to take that into consideration first and foremost. Obviously, ideally, we'd like to get to overcome the issues that we have right now with just moving bicycles down, but priority is obviously making sure, as John said, that if the ambiance in the area is preferable at the moment, then how do we ensure that access is granted, but not at the detriment of other people that need that priority access.
Right. So, what are you actually saying? Are you saying that we open the vehicle access ramps for everyone, or just for cyclists, or for cyclists and pedestrians?
As John said, I think it makes sense to put pedestrians and cyclists, if we can, on that access ramp at the moment. But obviously to make sure that the access that's granted to anybody else that doesn't have access at the very moment doesn't necessarily impact adversely upon the other users.
Okay.
What I'm trying to say is that at the moment, deliveries come in a truck down the ramp, and there's no reason why that can't continue and still be used and accessible for people with bicycles, and the footway widened, because it's quite a big ramp. So there isn't any reason. And I imagine you still need to allow the fire brigade and ambulance service access to that. So it's all doable.
Okay, we're going to move on. David has some questions.
Thank you, convener. My questions are to Mr. Mair, but obviously if any other members of the panel wish to intervene, please catch my or the commuter's eye. How does CPT work to improve integration of bus and rail services?
CPT has an overseeing role to represent the industry in a number of forums, from the bus stakeholder group that the Minister set up some months back to working with regional transport partnerships and local authorities where required. So we work across the full spectrum of national politics, local politics, regional politics, and other partners such as MACs, other disabled groups, to try and get a solution to the many challenges that people are faced with and using the bus. So really we'll work with anybody to try and improve things as best we can.
And I think I know the answer to this, but how receptive are Networked Rail and ScotRail to your suggestions?
We haven't met yet with Abellio. We did early doors indicate that we'd be happy to offer up our facilities to start discussions between the operators generally and Abellio, and by implication, I suppose, in the new arrangement, Network Rail would come as part of that with the integrated approach they have now. So we indicated that early doors. We haven't met with them yet. I've been to some briefings. I understand that they have a fairly good approach to that kind of thing back in Holland, and we are keen to pick up on that here in Scotland.
You'll know that the committee carried out a survey on accessibility, and I think it was one of the highest responses that any committee has had. So I'd like to thank all the work that's gone into this and all the people who have responded. And some of the concerns were probably obvious ones, that that accessibility to railway stations, there was real concerns that bus stops and routes could be located far from the local station. Can you explain why this is often the case?
Probably historically. Bus routes have been in place for a long time, and it needs that kind of discussion. That, for example, I mentioned earlier that SBT have set up a transport integration forum. City Edinburgh Council have done similarly. And I think working through that kind of forum can highlight these kind of issues. And if there is a need to look at the location of bus stops, then it can be done on a local basis, and the bus company and the local station manager can try and work together and come up with a solution that addresses that problem.
And in your experience, does that happen very often? If you've got responses from customers that the bus stop's in the wrong place, how often, how easy is it to move a bus stop or indeed change a route?
It requires a registration process to go through. We certainly wouldn't get complaints coming to us. They would probably go to the local bus company or local authority. And that's the kind of thing that you would see that partnership arrangement working best on. And it harks back a wee bit to John's red line, that you need to go beyond that and look at the journey to the bus stop, to the railway station, and identify if there are issues, then get people in the room and get on and try and fix it. But it does need a process to go through in terms of registration change, which I think at best is 56 days, 70 days at worst, but can be circumnavigated by, for example, the local authority supporting a short-term registration.
Okay. A final question, and Mr. Kenmuir has already touched on this in his earlier contributions. Again, in the survey, there was complaints about the lack of information for onward journeys by bus, including timetables and real-time information at or near railway stations. How are your members working with Network Rail and ScotRail to address these issues?
Well, it's varied. I think if you in Aberdeen, there's an electronic screen that you can tap into, and it will tell you the nearby bus stops, the services that operate. I think there's a real-time link. That happens in Aberdeen, but it's not consistent across the stations in Scotland. The one thing that you can use is in advance of your journey, you could go in and use Travel Line Scotland, for example. Or if you're travelling, you have a smartphone, and it doesn't have to be the most expensive smartphone in the world. You can tap into Travel Line Scotland and pick the bus stop that you want from the station. It will geographically show you the bus stops. It will tell you the services at the bus stops. If there's a real-time link, it will tell you the real time. So Travel Line Scotland, in the absence of anything else, is probably the best tool that you could suggest anybody to use.
So, I mean, that is, if you like, good practice, but clearly the people who've contacted us have said that their experience is that it doesn't happen in lots of areas, or they can't access that.
Well, I think it goes back to that issue of working closer together with Network Rail, ScotRail, local authorities, and trying to get the best practices that are around in Scotland delivered in the different locations. But best practice, in the absence of that, is Travel Line Scotland. It works fantastically well. It covers rail, bus, ferries, right across Scotland. So you can link the journey up. You can get information on each of the different components. If you want to walk, it will tell you walking. I'm not sure that it covers cycling, but it's there. It works, and it works extremely well.
Mm. But yet, in answer to your earlier questions, I think all the panellists were saying that they had very little communication with Network Rail.
Well, yeah, we need to try and, we're perhaps as much to blame for that as well. We should be pushing harder for that kind of discussions to be taking place.
Any of the other panellists like to make any comments on any questions that I've raised?
Just one, Mr. Stewart. to be fair to First Group, they were very good in terms of signage for cycle routes at stations. I would like to acknowledge that. They did a really good job for us and were very helpful. And there are signs for the National Cycle Network where it's within a couple of miles of every station, particularly on the lines up to Aberdeen, Inverness. So due credit there. They were very helpful and worked well with us.
Thank you. Anybody else like to contribute? Right. Thank you, convener.
Did you have a question, Mike?
A brief one, and I'm sure Dave Stewart would agree with me in raising this point, and it's more really just to get it on the record that I'm raising it. What Mr. Mair has described, I think, in theory, is an excellent system, but I'm sure he would agree with me that it depends on, you know, a reasonable connectivity in terms of 2G, 3G. These systems work and can work extremely well where you have that. But you mentioned that it applies also to ferries, and I would just point out, representing the Highlands and Islands, that most of our ferries in the Highlands and Islands operate in areas where there is very, very poor connectivity, and therefore these excellent systems can really be of use to ferry users. And I just wonder if you would acknowledge that point.
I'm certainly an IT expert, but I recognise the challenge that you've set up. I remember raising that in a meeting I had with Highland Council, who are looking to put in an electronic bidding process for tenders. And they said that in that part of the world, there's probably better IT than some other parts of Scotland, because they've had early adoption of new technology. Certainly, working out for Scotland, travelling to a location to pick up a ferry, you would get a signal if you go into the coffees and shops. And you know, there are many, many places now you can go and get Wi-Fi free.
I'm sorry to, you know, sometimes it's true, what you're saying is true, that you can, on occasion, get Wi-Fi. Often, though, it's linked to a landline connection that itself has got very poor broadband. And as more people use the devices, that gets effectively choked off. But I would concede the point that Inverness itself has a kind of reasonable connectivity. But thank you anyway.
Mr. Donlan, you have some questions.
Thank you. Can I go back to the question asked about Queen Street? We have excellent facilities there just now. After the redevelopment, how do you see that changing in terms of taxi access and egress, I suppose, because more importantly, very often, is that for people coming off the train? Just now, it's nice. You can go in, you can wait undercover and then get the taxi right there. How do you see that being affected?
I conferred with our colleagues at Glasgow Taxis just yesterday, Mr. Dornan, and they would agree with you that Queen Street Station works very well. They are maybe a little unclear if any significant change to the current taxi arrangements is planned going forward, but as things stand at the moment, they're relaxed about that. So the station is working well, and we're not aware of any major changes for taxi provision.
Your answer brings on another question, right enough. You said that they're a bit unclear about how they're going to be affected. So what sort of discussions have you had with the Network Rail?
Those have been at a local level between Glasgow, with Glasgow Taxis rather than the Scottish Taxi Federation. The way that I should have phrased that was that they didn't give me any indication that they were expecting any substantial change to the current situation once the plans have been completed.
Right, OK. Now, we've talked plenty about Edinburgh Waverley. Are there any other major Scottish railway stations where provisions for taxis is particularly poor?
No. I think that, you know, the Waverley, the recent change has been controversial, and we had some notice that it was going to happen. This might sound like a contradiction. We knew that it was tabled, but when it happened very quickly and with little notice. So that's been an issue in itself. But generally speaking, taxis are in close proximity to the stations and they're dealing with dropping off and picking their passengers up at a local level.
Just for the record, what was the notice period?
Well, anecdotally, I heard from transport people in the City of Edinburgh Council that they found out about the final date for change by reading it in the evening news, and that was where I got my information.
That's helpful, thank you.
Sorry, not at all. She got me back. The last one is about signage. We had a number of witnesses complaining about signage when they leave the stations about how they move forward to their next mode of transport. How do you accept that that's a problem? And secondly, how would you go about improving the signage in and around the station to assist passengers? I'll start with you, Mr. Kenmuir, but I'm sure others would want to respond.
Certainly, I'm conscious that the last thing anybody wants in a pedestrian environment is bristling with signs. I understand that. One of the proposals for the further development of connecting with, sorry to come back to Waverley Station, but with Waverley Station is to move the major taxi provision to Calton Road. I have to say the development of the entrance there is terrific. It's a relatively quiet road. The new drive-in has been really well designed and built. Unfortunately, the only way to get to the station then is on a lift and into the network. It's a drop-off only at the present time, but there's a suggestion that a taxi rank on Calton Road might become the main provision. In principle, that's an excellent idea. Unfortunately, Calton Road at the moment exits onto Leith Street, the top of Leith Walk. You can only turn left onto Princey Street, and you then have to drive past the taxi rank that's on Waverley Steps. So, unfortunately, that doesn't really lead you anywhere. Our major concern with moving taxis anywhere would be the provision of signage, which is there are some signs that say the word taxi on them if you look hard enough, but they're not obvious, and neither are the signs for assistance.
A change in the position of the taxi ranks, would you be informed of that in advance, or be given some help along to organise the signage?
Well, these conversations have mostly been taking place between ourselves and the City of Edinburgh Council. And the council, in turn, have been suggesting that they would put the necessary pressure onto Network Rail to provide the signage.
Okay, thank you. Does anybody else have any? Mr. Lauder, and then Mr. Mair.
Thank you, Mr. Donnan. I think from the point of view of the pedestrian or anyone using a bicycle, signage is really important, particularly knowing the best route to get to a station. And I, on my regular commute in to my office, which is at Haymarket, I do speak quite frequently, usually to visitors who are trying to figure out the way to Haymarket Station, very often when they're only about a half mile or less from it. So it does take me back to the issue around when a station is being redeveloped. What's the radius for people walking to it, and what's the radius for people getting to it by bicycle, and how can you sign? I think people rely on signs, I think, more than any other, more than clever technology or maps. It's signs on the street that they go, oh, that's great, right, I'll follow that sign. That will take me to whichever station I want to get to. So it's Queen Street, I'm looking for Queen Street, there's a sign. And it would be unthinkable to develop a road network to drive on without signage. But quite often it's an afterthought for people who are walking or who are cycling. I think it does take me back to the idea that when you're redeveloping or just even promoting a station, there's a sum of money which is available out with the boundary of the physical station itself, and you can then employ whoever it is, the local authority or whoever, to do a signage schedule for those key routes from hotels, the places that people stay in when they're near a station, to get to the station. So I think quite often there's a feeling that the station's impermeable because you don't know where it is in relation to where you are in the city round about you. So signage is massively important for people who are walking.
I know the answer to this, but what sort of discussions have SUSTRANS had with Network Rail and the local authorities about the signage?
None. Okay. We would only have... I should pause there. We would have discussions if the National Cycle Network, which we're responsible for, was running near to the station. But out with that, none. But we do talk to local authorities quite a lot more now through the government's new funding stream, Smarter Choices, Smarter Places, which is very welcome, which allows local authorities to invest more in signing plans and schedules around. But there's no coherence between Network Rail, local authority, and groups like ourselves.
Okay, thank you very much.
I just wanted to talk add a bit to what John has said in terms of the potential is huge around stations for getting people to walk or cycle to them. In Scotland, a cycle journey is about 4.4 kilometres on average. It's actually similar to the Netherlands and Denmark, which is a very high modal share, and they average about 3 to 4 kilometres. So if you draw a 5-kilometre ring around each of the stations that are identified in the study here, it's a huge amount of population of people that actually access that, that are then able to then access employment, education, friends and family visiting, services and leisure. To use employment as an example, and we're focusing on sort of the main stations, but as I was saying before, the door-to-door journey is very important. So if you look at places like East Renfrewshire, which is a satellite of Glasgow, lots of people use the train. Approximately 15 to 20% of those within 2 kilometres of a station use the train to travel to work. So it's a huge amount of people already engaged in the train. Now, John's point was definitely about making sure people understand where the cycle routes are, where the walking routes are, what the distance is. It's also additionally about just, in essence, promoting the fact that it is possible to do, to travel by foot or by bike to those stations. So having good signage is obviously good for those people who need to find their way and have decided that they want to travel by foot or by bike. But you know, there's a huge potential there in terms of identifying people that maybe hadn't thought about it at first. They see good cycle parking, for example. They see the signage that's there in place, and then they will actually utilize a bike or walk by foot or travel by foot to that station, and enjoy all the benefits of possibly changing to a low carbon mode.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mair. Do you have any comment?
Many of the local authorities have bus operator forums, and bus signage at railway stations is an issue that very often is on the agenda. But I'm not quite sure that we actually close the loop in terms of the local authority then working with Network Rail and ScotRail to actually deliver something. So probably there's a need to go back and look at how we can improve that and get the loop closed and get some of the improvements that people have asked for, because it is important that people can arrive in a train station and have a good idea that if they go the door at the left, I can get this bus. If it's the one to the right, then my options are A, B and C. We're not quite there yet in some locations, but it is that loop being closed that is the important issue.
That sounds like a good idea. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Mike.
Thank you, Convener. And just before I start, I would like to commend Mr. Lauder for the terrific work that SUSTRANS have done across the Highlands and Islands in providing that cycle network and pathways. The committee undertook its own survey of passengers on this issue of accessibility of stations, and one of the interesting things that we found was that cyclists were much more likely to give very poor ratings for accessibility and general friendliness for the perimeters around stations than other station users. Would you agree with that? And can you shed any light on why cyclists in particular are so critical of this aspect of...
Thank you for the question. I think it goes back to that stations do create a lot of movement. They're busy places. Getting to and from them, naturally, there'll be a lot of movement of vehicles on the streets around about stations or on the roads to stations. Understandably, taxis are plying their trade. Buses have got to drop people off and pick people up and move them. That just creates a general sense of busyness in the streets around. So the closer you get to the station, generally the more congested the roads will get, and that's what we're focusing here on, the big stations, and that's definitely the experience, that the closer you get, the busier the road gets. Setting aside the Haymarket, where you've now got the added the added concern about dropping your front wheel into the tram line. So putting that aside, you are simply experiencing more and more busyness as you get to it, and because you've got busy roads, they will not have the type of segregated cycle lane that you would get in a northern European city, and therefore you're mixing all the time with traffic, and that can be tricky, that can be challenging. You have some quite busy roads right outside stations. Haymarket Terrace, for example, in Edinburgh, very busy. Traffic wanting to move at 30 miles per hour, therefore accelerating, decelerating, and just a general sense of having to really look out for yourself, which makes getting to a station on a bicycle not a pleasant experience at all. Now, sometimes you might have the good experience, say, for example, Central Station in Glasgow, where there is a segregated two-way cycle lane coming down Waterloo Street. That's great, very, very good, but that's one way to get to the station. Otherwise, I think that is why people will be so very, very unhappy. And then I imagine people will be unhappy because, as in our evidence and as Nathan's covered, there's probably very, very little space outside the station to park your bicycle, and then getting your bicycle into the station to then park it is difficult. And then you just have, in the case of Queen Street, quite limited parking around the station, so you're probably looking for a place to park your bike. You're mixing with pedestrians when you do that. You're bumping into people, which you don't want to do. You're just getting in everybody's way. Whereas the experience, I think, in other small northern European countries would be there'll be a definite place to park your bike. It'll be substantial. You'll know you'll be able to park it, and you won't have to mix with pedestrians or people getting in and out of taxis. And I think it does some, and I'm sorry if I sound like a stuck record on it, but I do think it's where, you know, there is a physical red line drawn around the development, and we'll focus on what happens inside that. Outside that, the local authority can deal with that, and if the local authority haven't got a budget with which to perhaps lower traffic speeds, reallocate road space, just make the whole experience better and more predictable for somebody on a bicycle, therefore nothing will be improved, and the whole emphasis will just be on finding your way and figuring out where you're going to go next.
Thank you. I mean, you've anticipated my next question. That's very useful. So would it be fair to say then that the solution to this problem, or the possibilities for improvement, would perhaps lie more with local authorities then than with Network Rail?
I think it's a combination. I really do, which is a difficult thing. Then you've got to bring different people together. You have Network Rail anticipating increased demand and increasing patronage, so therefore more people are being drawn to their facility. You've got the local authority, who are almost cut out of the loop in terms of providing improved access to that to the facility. You may have a very large budget which is improving the facility, but the budget can't be used outside the station boundary. And I think it should be possible to bring those together. It happens in other respects, you know, it happens with major developments or retail as well. So people can work together. Finally, the final point would be it works with, say, housing, for example. So housing developments, traffic implications are looked at quite rigorously before the development's given approval. And I'm not sure that happens. Nathan might know more, but I'm not sure that happens with stations. I don't know that the station or Network Rail need to talk to the local authority on how we're going to cope with the increased demand to it. So I don't think it's one person's job or another. I think it's about bringing people together to work and use public funds in a better way.
Anybody else get anything to add?
I would just echo John's comments about I think the best outcome is would be for everybody to be working together to try and make it so simple and easy that people want to come back and experience it, the whole thing once again, and become regular users of rail. And bus and taxis and whatever means they use to get to the station. But I think it has to start at the beginning and work its way through to the station, into the station, into the platform. And then, you know, even things like if you're on an intermediate point, if I board my train on a Thursday evening to back up to Aberdeen at Waverley, I can go at the train and find carriage A. If I'm on the platform at Haymarket, A could either be at the front or be at the back. And you have that
you know, why in this day and age, when you get to providing information to the public to make things easier, why can we never have the situation that the train, as it leaves a station, always has carriage A at the front? If you're, I find it really difficult with Haymarket trying to deal with that. Is it the front? Is it the back? Everybody's running back and forth to get their seat that they've booked, to get people that are, even with assistance, it must be horrendous. So making it simple and easy for people to use so that you always know that A is going to be at the front, it would save so much hassle. And if we all work with that thought in mind, as John suggested, then, you know, I think we could get a good result.
In terms just of my earlier question, I've got the sense from all the witnesses, both at today's session and last week's session, that Network Rail have been perhaps not as good as they could have been in engaging with stakeholders. In terms of what the suggestion was, that you know there needs to be better collaboration between Network Rail and the local authorities, do you feel, is it possible to give a sense of, is the reason for that not happening a reluctance on the part of Network Rail, or is it just not really on the agenda at all that these two public organisations should be talking to each other?
I think you've hit the nail on the head there, that it's simply not been on the agenda. I've been very conscious of some change over the past year to 2 years in the City of Edinburgh Council in particular, and much more focus on integration. It's a shame that integration tends to become an item on the agenda once a project's completed. The concept of modern transport is an item one on the agenda, is how does it integrate? I hate to mention the tram, but you know that's taught us some more lessons there about where do you pick someone up and drop them off if they want to get on a tram. On York Place you don't, on Princes Street you don't, and at the West End you don't, because cars aren't allowed there. So integration is something that's bandied about, and it's a word that comes into this any discussion about transport, but it's rarely acted upon. And I've appreciated John's comments about this red line. That's a good way of picturing it. I hadn't thought about it that way, but it seems clear to me that the managers of transport hubs are focused very much on, once they've captured the customer, what do they do with them? But they haven't thought about how they get there and how they leave, which seems fundamental to the concept of transport. But unfortunately, it's so often missing.
Thank you very much. I used to be a joiner, so I'm glad I can still hit the odd nail on the head. And thank you, convener.
Adam.
No.
Okay, in that case, can I ask the witnesses if there's anything that they would like to put in the record that they haven't had an opportunity to say this morning? John?
There's just one thing which I did put in my evidence, and I appreciate it is out with the scope of your inquiry, but it is to commend the work of the team developing the Borders Line in Network Rail, who've been really good to work with, and we've been involved with that project right from the moment the proposal was granted and it went moving forward. And that was because the project sponsor in Network Rail was also the project sponsor for Airdrie Bathgate. And we were involved in Airdrie Bathgate because we had a cycle route on the railway line, which was then quite rightly reinstated. And we worked with that person for quite a number of years. And as a result of that, I think the integration's been very good between Network Rail, Midlothian, Borders, groups like ourselves who've had budgets and they've been able to utilise budgets that we manage. And I think that access to the stations along the Borders Line is, I'm hoping, is going to be really quite good for foot and for people arriving with a bicycle. So just to mention that, but I know it's out with the scope of what you're looking at.
Thank you for that. I'm going to ask each of the witnesses to leave the committee with a take-home message and to be as brief as possible. Well, what's the one thing you would want us to take away from today's session?
If I may, I think I just gave my closing speech. And that is the earlier the integration is considered in any development, the better for all concerned.
Mr. Mair?
Generally encouraging closer working between the key partners in this, working hard to deliver simple and easy to understand information on how you link journeys up.
Okay, thank you.
Just to reaffirm what I mentioned before in terms of you know, the policies and the commitments are there, particularly around the shared vision of 10% plus the long-term vision on active travel. And I think it's just to encourage all parties involved to reaffirm their commitment to that and take actions to deliver on that vision.
And in terms of access to urban railway stations specifically?
In terms of access to urban railway stations, as everyone sort of mentioned here, following on from that is to learn from the things that have actually been positive and have been successful in Scotland, such as, for example, the Stirling Cycle Hub and other various aspects that have helped improve access for people who are cycling in those particular areas, and learn from them and share that information and find out ways to be able to implement those good practices across each of these mainline stations.
Okay. Mr. Lauder, you have the last word.
Oh, gosh. That's a dangerous thing to do with me. I would just draw the committee's attention to recommendations 3 and 4 in our paper. I'm actually quite hopeful. I think that with the appointment of Abellio and the new management structure, we could be on the eve of a much more coherent way to look at how we access our major urban rail stations. So that's a very positive. There are some simple steps. He said simple steps at point 3, which I think could be tackled now. And I think point 4, we've all said the same thing, which is essentially there needs to be a change in culture and a much less siloed approach to how transport is delivered, especially because it's all being delivered with public money in terms of how stations are built and how local authorities operate. So that being the case, I would want to see those silos broken down and a much better team approach to how transport's delivered.
Okay. Can I thank the witnesses for their evidence this morning, and I'll now allow a brief pause for witnesses to leave the room. Thank you. Our second agenda item is for the committee to consider its annual report for the parliamentary year between the 11th of May 2014 and the 10th of May 2015. Can I invite any general comments that members have on the draft annual report which has been circulated in advance of today's meeting? David.
Yeah, my view is that the report was well drafted and I think summarised the various issues we've raised. Could I just mention, as far as European issues were concerned, the committee kindly made me the EU reporter, just to say that I've arranged to go to Brussels in the first week of the recess to pick up a few general transport and funding issues, particularly on EU funding. So just for the record, to let members know that I'm pursuing the EU reporter with vigour and energy.
Yes, I don't think that impacts on the content of a report, but that's a very helpful clarification, Mr. Stewart. Anyone else? Right, so there's no comments, no changes on the report. Yes, of course.
I understand that the annual reports, I think that the clerk was involved in this, will be in a new format in the future, which are a lot more user-friendly.
I think this is already in a new format, is that correct?
When it's completed.
I believe that when this is published, I'm reliably informed by Clark that there will be photographs and graphics that will provide a different look to the report from previous years. Photographs of matters that are relevant to the activities of the committee.
I think the key, certainly I saw some drafts in the past, that I think is a great project, and I think it will make the annual reports of all committees a lot more sort of readable and accessible, and we should really be encouraging that and using the sort of journalistic inputs as well, which is worth doing.
Okay. Do members have any further comments on the content of the report? In that case, can I invite members to agree the report and to publish this on Friday the 5th of June?
Agreed.
Agreed. Thank you. We are agreed. I now move this meeting into private session.